is I wanted to open up with one question to everybody. So sum up 2022 in one sentence for me to be here. Anyone want to start? Let's just go with you, Rob. Let's go in order.
22, we learned how to wear our dancing shoes. And we really, I think there was so much chaos going on from 20 to 21. 22, we really got good at dancing and responding to surprises and chaotic events much more gracefully.
Yeah. So I'll start with a Dickens quote to start the morning here. So it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, right? I think, you know, demand, revenue were really strong, but supply chain and inflation and material costs really made it a very challenging year at the same time.
I would call 2022 managed chaos. It was a lot of externalities coming into our business from all the same items that you just mentioned there, but you know, it's our responsibility to manage them and still run the business.
Yeah. Thank you. So with our panel here, what we wanted to do, the theme for this year is resiliently transforming the future. Kind of taking a theme from what Paul said, the innovator's dilemma. We have to focus on the here and now, but we also have to innovate for tomorrow. And so a couple of themes will come out from this panel. We have operational resilience. How do you make sure your operations are resilient? Kind of some of the themes you guys just talked about. How is the future transformation driving business today? And then finally, how are current economics affecting business? Things like workforce, material cost inflation, things like that. But I want to start with a topic that's got a lot of interest lately. And Ken, we'll start with you. Talking about how the market in China, not only the commercial market, but the geopolitical market. How is that affecting your business? How is that affecting how you manage and lead and think about the future as you go forward as a whole?
Yeah, thanks. China's been a difficult place to do business in the last three years or so since COVID. Really changed some of the assumptions that we had about the globalization that was taking place in the previous decade or so. So you, I think as manufacturers in this industry, you really have to rethink how can you support that. Now, I know that many people in that large of an economy, there will still be a domestic economy there. But from our point of view, we want to maintain that as its domestic economy. Using it as an export is really where we're reevaluating. Many supply positions that were single sourced in China coming into the U.S. or in our company into Europe was highly disrupted. It's disrupted via supply chain, very high cost of shipping. We all know this. Container costs being disrupted right now in COVID environments, being disrupted in tariff fees that are being put on the product. So in many cases, really question whether you single source that product in China or you just use it as a second or third level choice, or if at all.
Yeah. So it sounds a lot like China's becoming a China market in the future. It's,
I still think there are good suppliers in China. There are, you know, you wouldn't want to put 100% of your reliance on them for your markets.
Yeah. Jeff, Rob, any comments on this question?
Yeah, I think you have to look at total cost.
Yeah.
When you look at China, 20 years ago, China was a really great place to operate because the costs were so competitive. But today, it really is not even close to as competitive as other nearshore opportunities like Mexico.
Yeah.
And then if you tack in the inventory that's required to have all your, you know, have the containers moving all the time, the cost of freight, tariffs, of course, it becomes a much more, it's not nearly the advantages that were there before calling aren't there anymore.
Yeah.
So we've done the same thing. We've shifted our manufacturing in China to focus on the China market, Southeast Asia, and Australia. We've done all that we can to halt production of goods coming to the U.S. We still have some, but we've set up in Vietnam for that purpose to avoid some of the tariffs that plaguing us from the China side. But the reality is, for us, we're looking at nearshoring. Everything is about moving closer and reducing inventories and improving the quality levels and cycle times.
Yep.
So that was a challenge with China.
Jeff?
Yeah, I think, you know, it still makes perfect sense to support the China market with China production. The business model that had production moving to China to support the North American market, I think, has fundamentally changed. And you know, we've been for the last 4 or 5 years trying to move as much of our component supply, you know, back to North America as possible.
continuing on the line of, okay, so the business model has fundamentally changed in China. Rob and Jeff, Rob, we'll start with you. Thinking about Mexico, how has your experience been? What is your roadmap going forward of thinking about how you supply parts and products in the North American market?
Yeah, so if I look back at my 28-year career, the decision back when I was 7 to move to Mexico was probably the best of my career. So we're very bullish on Mexico. I'm a huge fan of the workers, the level of experience from the engineering perspective. The college system is spectacular in Mexico. We don't have labor issues. We have people that line up. So we've gone from a 32,000 square foot, 70 person plant to 500,000 square feet now, and close to 1,700 employees. So that business has really taken off. We've continued to expand it. It's the cleanest factory that we have anywhere in the world. It's the best, in my opinion, the best managed, the best organized. So we're continuing to invest really heavily in Mexico. We've got Philips Connect that we're now building a facility across the street to be the first telematics provider to manufacture in Mexico. So we're going all in. We've seen so much success from there that we're continuing to expand. And the proximity of the states makes it even better.
Definitely follow up. Well, I agree with everything Rob said. You know, when you look at the key factors that influence where to put your production capacity, things like, you know, availability and cost of labor, proximity to customers, proximity to the supply base, I think all of those arrows, you know, kind of point to Mexico as being a really good choice. Velvac has tripled our footprint on both sides of the border over the last 5 years. And I think that's allowed us to be more cost competitive, more responsive to our customers, and have better control of our quality at the same time. I think one of the other observations I would make is the maturation of the supply base in Mexico. 15, 20 years ago, it was the main industries there were appliances and light automotive vehicles, and you really didn't have much of a supply base for sort of our mid-range volumes in this industry. But that's there now to a much greater extent, and it's allowing us to bring a lot of that back from information.
How about setting up business, working with government officials, just the ease of doing business? Is it similar to the United States, a little bit different? Is it more difficult? What's your early take on that? Or just your opinion on that?
Maybe a statistic first that almost 50% of the commercial vehicle trucks, Class 8 trucks, made in North America are made in Mexico. So it's a growing market from that perspective that services much of fuel far aftermarket. So it's being proven by our customers, Daimler, Navistar, Kenworth, in those regions. SAF Holland recently, in the last 6 months, has acquired Haldex, a braking brand, and they have a wonderful operation in Monterrey and have been there for the last 3 or 4 years and done a really nice job, all the same outputs that Rob described. We are building a new manufacturing plant in Border City, Piedras Negras, as well, where Utility has a trailer plant. So it's really becoming a good subsector for commercial vehicles. But I would say easy to do business. I mean, they're good business development, government officials,